Good evening. Welcome to the Northampton City Council meeting of February 16, 2017. I'm City Council President Bill Dwight, and I'll be presiding. As is our custom, we'll give the public an opportunity to speak. I actually don't have anyone on the sign-up list, but just for folks watching at home, we invite you to come speak to the council on any topic. Doesn't have to be business that we're addressing. It can be actually on any subject, as long as you comport yourself in accordance to the rules of decorum here in the council chambers. So if you're watching at home and sometime you want to participate and or just air your feelings on some issue, please come in, step up, and you get 3 minutes to speak your piece. But we don't have anyone signed up for public comment tonight, so I'm going to ask the administrative assistant, when she's fully assembled, to call the roll.
Councilor Bidwell.
Here.
Councilor Carney.
Present.
Councilor Dwight.
Here.
Councilor Klein.
Here.
Councilor LaBarge.
Present.
Councilor Nash.
Here.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Here.
Councilor Scherer.
Here.
All right, we have a quorum, so we are convened. First off, I'm going to start with an announcement of a public hearing. This is concerning a petition to locate poles, wires, and fixtures as described on Barrett Street. The petition is from National Grid and Verizon New England Incorporated, and this is in accordance with the provisions of Section 22, Chapter 166 of the General Laws. A public hearing will be held March 2nd, 2017 at 7:05 p.m. here in Council Chambers at 212 Main Street on the petition of National Grid and Verizon New England Incorporated to locate poles, wires, and fixtures upon, along, under, or across one or more public ways in the city of Northampton. And the petition concerns pole number 15 on Barrett Street as described in our attached plan. Are there any one-minute announcements? Yes. Councilor LaBarge.
I want to thank Councilor at-large Ryan O'Donnell for attending the meeting that we had at Ryan Road School, and it was very well attended, and hopefully we do have some residents who had concerns about the closeness toward the road. So Wayne and I are working on doing more of a setback going for the houses there, but I want to thank you for being there.
Thank you, Councilor.
Any other one-minute announcements or some such or others? Okay. Antonio, we've come up to you. This is actually, first, the communications proclamations from the mayor. The mayor may have other items too, so your honor.
Yes. I actually don't have any other items other than just to sort of remind counselors that last year we came to you with a request for a transfer from undesignated fund balance to fund a broadband study, which was to take a look at our existing IT infrastructure, our wireless area network infrastructure, and to look at its capacity, its improvements that needed to be made internally, and then potential ways to leverage that asset that we have spent lots of money developing and building over the last several years. So the study itself has been completed, and I've asked Mr. Pagan, our Chief Information Officer, to come and give you a presentation. I did want to say that we've uploaded a copy of the study that he'll be giving you the presentation on to the city website, and on the mayor's office page, there's a separate page that's all policy studies and management assessments, and the study itself is there as well, so you can have access to it there to read the whole thing in full. But he's going to give you a kind of a quick overview of it. So I would ask Antonio Pagan to come and make the presentation. He's currently hijacking your screen there wirelessly.
He's overwriting.
Not this time.
Oh, not this time. Okay.
Because I couldn't see the IP address before. Good night. Thank you very much for having me here. I need to see that IP address in order to hack you. You have to close. Yeah. There you go. Okay, thank you. Okay, it's going to take me a couple of minutes because I just arrived and being able to get there.
Yeah, don't worry, we're all behind schedule, so we're fine. That's the problem, we're ahead of schedule.
We are, yeah.
Do you need help or do you have it?
I am downloading the app.
Okay, great.
Yeah.
Yep.
Thank you. Okay, not yet there. I need to download it again.
So this is the study from the Collins Group again.
That's not it.
Isn't it?
It's actually further over to the right, and there's a problem with the. I think there's a. I just noticed a problem with the link. So
yeah, I was going to say the link.
So it's not working.
Okay. Talking to my other IT person on so because the link, I just noticed the link is not working, so I'll get that fixed.
Well, because I have a link that says the IT assessment.
And that's an IT organizational study.
That's what I was looking at. So this sounded.
Yeah, no. But if you go over to the far right tab, the broadband study.
Oh, got it.
But it's not working right now. So
the link.
She knows.
Yeah.
So hang tight. It'll be operational shortly.
Same as there. If I email it to you, can you put it there?
Me?
Yeah.
Okay. I couldn't get the link up.
It's just the perfect picture.
Ooh, the irony.
Yeah.
Okay. I want to see how.
So you downloaded the app?
Yeah, I downloaded the app, but.
Where's the app? Did you open it?
No, it didn't open.
I want to be like flipping.
Oh, geez. Okay.
Trying to avoid that.
Yeah, I would email it.
Okay. Okay. If you, so I can start talking without the presentation and then go if you don't mind.
No, not at all. Go ahead.
So basically, we've been discussing for almost a year the different options for getting the fiber. I'm pretty sure you are all familiar with the municipal fiber that has been developed since 2009, and it's been servicing all 26 buildings throughout the city. But it's been doing so far is, you know, it's been a fantastic tool for all the municipal buildings to connect together, to all the departments to work together. The phone system actually is being possible because of the fiber. And the schools, obviously, are taking advantage of it as well. And Smith-Vogue is a part of the network, including the library. So all the buildings on the municipal side and the schools are connected through that fiber. Historically, what has happened in the past is that after the fiber structure is mature and is working, cities and municipalities start using the fiber for other purposes beyond just connecting the departments. And one of them that is becoming more and more, I would say, advantageous for both the municipal side and for the schools is to actually start using the fiber to provide bandwidth to the schools. And by doing that, the city becomes an ISP for the schools. And that is happening in several cities and towns in Massachusetts. The one that is using it the best is Boston. Boston has been doing it for the last 3 years. And they are creating definitely a bigger network and a much better services to the schools by using the fiber. That is actually the document, the presentation. Once my computer decides to restart, I will get to it. So by following the trend of many cities in United States, not only in Massachusetts, to take advantage of the fiber to make it more usable and basically have some return on investment out of the fiber, we decided, the mayor decided to hire a contractor, a consultant, to do a study of, you know, what is the state of our fiber, what is the market around us for fiber services, and, you know, whether it's feasible to use it for the school as a provider, and whether it's feasible to use it for non-educational purposes or commercial purposes. And I want to say that if you get the study and read it, you will find out there that there is several times there are more than one concern about, you know, how to go about growing with the use of the fiber. It's not, you know, it's not something that you can just grow exponentially all the sudden. There's a lot of investment on growing. But the most advisable route is to take advantage of the fiber to start providing services to schools, because there is no a big investment to do that, because basically the connections are already there. It's just basically that are not using that way. So it's better repurposing the structure to do it. So we are going back here, and hopefully you will be able to see the presentation. So one thing that the consultants were very strong on their report to emphasize is that Northampton has several providers of fiber. Comcast is here, Verizon is here, Light Tower is here, and there are other providers, minor services, and they do some kind of services. So the whole idea of getting the fiber infrastructure to be used for other services has to be studied a little deeper than just the analysis that was done by the consultant at this point. So that is basically the framework where the study was done. The consultant Percipio, and is based on Texas, and they have done the same study for many other municipalities in the states, and they are very knowledgeable. So all the advices that are there are backed up by a lot of experience during more than 20 years of services. Besides what we have as part of the municipal fiber infrastructure, there's another advantage that the city has, and is an agreement that we have with Five College Network that was signed about 7 years ago. And it basically allows us to use the fiber from Five College Network to reach the infrastructure that is available in Springfield, and one building that is called One Federal in Springfield. Springfield Data Center is called also, used to be part of one manufacturing place there, and now is basically part of STCC. And it's also called STCC Technology Park. So we have a very low cost connection to that building that will allow us to get even better services without having, okay, let me, I'm going to email it to you now. And then, yeah, now that you are connected there, you can just go. So by using the five course network fiber and having access to Springfield, for example, and just to give a simple example of what is the advantage of that, for example, if we buy a bandwidth right now here in this building, it costs us, it could cost us maybe $5 to $7 meg of fiber of bandwidth, meaning we can have up to 100 meg, for example, that would be $500 to $700 a month. But if we buy the same bandwidth in Springfield, it's going to cost $3 or less. So that is a big advantage, and the cost for the five college network for us is basically a minimal, because we basically pay just a small amount of money for being connected there. And so that's another advantage that is also highlighted in the report, and you will be able to read as we distribute the report for you. Okay. So talking about that five college network is basically, I have to clarify that is not a permanent agreement. It's an agreement for 5 years. It has been already renewed for another 5 years, so it's now due to be revisited at 2019. And that's when we will decide whether we will continue using it or if we will increase the use of it for other purposes.
There you go.
You got it. You got it there. Okay. You can go. It's going to be. Go there. If I,
oh. Can we study goals?
No, it's go back once.
I wonder if she doesn't have your version of.
Yeah, I sent. Send that. Go back. Go back. Are you doing enter or?
No. Do you want me to enter?
No. Go back to to that one and then do the arrow keys.
So if you go try clicking enter.
Yeah, if for some reason it's not. Okay.
No.
Can you do something? Just escape out of there and go to the. Yeah. Go to. Let's see how we can do this. Let me go there. It's better if I go there. Technology is great when it works.
Yep.
It really doesn't have much money. Let's do this. Can you read that?
Yep.
So basically, we went through this already in terms of the goals of the study. The only one that I didn't mention is by extending the use of the fiber, we will enable our network to start going a little deeper in terms of smart city applications, you know, having more sensors or basically having the parking connected to our network, things like that, that we don't have now. So let's go to the next slide, if you can. Okay. Then we talk about the guiding principles, or basically what we discussed with the consultants to have as a way of them doing their job. I want to emphasize on point number three there, that we don't want to create the impression that the idea is to compete with the private sector. That's not the idea. In any case, would be to partner when there is an opportunity for partnering with private institutions. And definitely is the overall goal is to ensure that we enable the city to improve the quality of services that are provided. Next. Also, it is important that we are not thinking about doing, there's a concept that is very prevailing in other areas of the states, which is called fiber to the premises, which is basically, Greenfield is doing right now with wireless, which is basically providing fiber or bandwidth to every resident or business. And that's not the idea here. At this point, that could be an outcome later on if need be, but that's not what we're thinking to do now. And in any case, basically, we want to ensure that the structure that has been developed by the city will continue to be owned by the city. It's not going to, if there's partnership with private sector partners, they will not be taking over any infrastructure of the city. Next. So this is just an explanation of what we have, and we mentioned that already. We have more than 12 miles of cable throughout the city, including it goes all the way to Leeds, and in a good part of Florence is present also, mostly at the center of Florence and or where the schools are, basically we go with the fiber. Fortunately, we'll not be able to show the map there because the link doesn't go, it goes to my computer, so we will not be able to show that. Let's go next. So in terms of educational use, if the city decides to, you know, work on extending the network in order to provide services to schools, there is a process to go through where the city will become a service provider through the E-rate program, which is USAC. I'm sure if you are familiar with USAC, it's basically the a discount services program that we all pay. Every time you get a bill from any phone company, you are paying small amount, and believe it or not, they collect $10 billion a year, and they distribute it through different programs. They have four different programs, and the bigger one is the schools. So the city would need to become, or actually has to become, a service provider, and then buy the services on wholesale pricing, and then resell the services to the schools. And it could be in many ways, and I mentioned here four different ways of services that can be provided. That is a little technical, but if you want more details, you can see the study. Each one of the business models have benefits for the schools to use it. Next. Then the second option is to use it for commercial purposes. And that's where I say, you know, it's basically, let's put an example here. If there is a business in the center of the town that is looking for 200 meg of bandwidth, which is a speed that a lot of businesses are using these days, we will not compete with the providers that are providing that kind of speed. But if in the area there is no provided I can give that speed, then we are an alternative. As long as the fiber, our fiber is close by, we'll be able to provide it. The other point is that going into the future, most of the businesses are coming up today. They are talking about 1 gig of bandwidth or more, and that's where we have a capacity to do that. So we can really, for very little money, we can provide a gig, 2 gig, up to 10 gigs without adding a lot of equipment on our side, and that would be very reasonable to do it. We could do it by having partners with us. We can do it by developing this, the capacity that we have, or we can do it by actually using a provider that basically use our network as their backbone to do it. And that's another possibility, and those are the different business models that are there. Next. The recommendations on the report are, number one, to proceed with the E-rate participation. And because of the E-rate cycle, if we decide to do this, the mayor is inclined to do it as soon as possible, we will need to start doing the preparation for participating on the next cycle, which start in January of 2018, so that we'll have enough time to work on preparation. Central services should, you know, needs to be, to have the capacity to negotiate contracts with vendors for buying the bandwidth and then being able to provide that to the schools. And so we are not ready for this year because of the timing, but it's something that definitely can be started right away and have some effects on the bandwidth that the schools are going to be deploying next two school years from now. The second recommendation from the consultant was to employ a careful and incremental approach to expanding on the private side. And that would be, you know, starting from basically just looking at the policies. What are we doing as we grow in our own infrastructure, municipal infrastructure? Are we asking, you know, our own DPW construction is providing for the conduits that are going to be available for fiber in the future there? Are we asking for that kind of policies on planning, for example, on zoning? So those are the things that we have to revisit. Most of them have been taken care of, but that would be things that needs to be taken care about on a network master plan. It's more about policy, more about, you know, where we want to go, what are the opportunities that would bring us there. So that will bring us to the next steps, which is the last screen there. And basically, next step is to move ahead with all the paperwork to participate on the E-rate program, and then start working on the municipal network master plan that will take certain time, I would say, years to develop completely. And part of that is some laws in Massachusetts that will allow the city to become an ISP, basically, for non-educational institutions. And that is a process that by itself it takes a couple of years to do it. So that's what we have as a summary or overview of the report, but there's a lot of more details on the report, and if you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer.
Could I just add one quick thing and maybe just have you highlight it, because I know we kind of went, you were between presentations, but the whole issue of the ubiquitous deployment, because I know that's going to be a question that people are saying, why aren't we doing that? Like, why aren't we trying to rewire the entire city? And so maybe you, I know it's covered in the study, but you may want to just talk about that.
Yes.
And talk about why communities, including communities that Google has started to do that work with and then abandoned it because it was not feasible. I just want to mention that.
Yes.
And then also the fact that we do have a fully, almost fully wired city right now by private providers. So,
Yeah, that is being a trend. I would say 5 years ago, there was a trend that many cities attempted to basically start wiring with fiber, big areas of their own town or city, and also Google, as the mayor mentioned, has a division called Google Fiber, based on Texas also, and they actually attempted to develop projects in about 5 to 7 different cities. The biggest one of them, Austin in Texas. They were successful on some urban areas, but they were not successful on many areas. And they actually, last year by summer, they actually stopped their project. The reason for that is because 5 years ago, fiber was unaffordable, really. It was really expensive. Bandwidth was very expensive. And during the last 3 to 4 years, the price of bandwidth has come down dramatically. And the providers that we have today, like cable companies, has become also fiber providers. So they are taking advantage of their resources to basically increase the services they provide. And competing in that market is almost impossible at this point. It's, I'm not sure if you are familiar with NBI. It's a very good example of a network that was built here in the region maybe 7 years ago. And unfortunately, the pricing on the network, because of the way it was developed, is higher than competitors on the areas that on the areas that we have competitors, or the NBI has competitors. So developing fiber throughout the city beyond what we have is not really feasible at this point. It doesn't look like it's a project that could be maintained and be sustainable, because the return of investment is going to be maybe 50 years or something like that, which is not really reasonable for a project like this. So the recommendation on the reporting is extensive data in there is that as part of the increase on capacity, there's no opportunity at this point to start building fiber or any other services to the premises, to the residents or to businesses outside of any opportunity that might happen. And I'm going to make an example that could be maybe better. For example, if we have fiber coming to, let's say, the fire station, which we have, and there is a business that is going to be built in Route 5, and the services that they are looking for are not affordable on the incumbent services that exist right now, that might be an opportunity to create some services specifically for that client. And that would be an opportunity, but not necessarily something that we will look forward to do unless it's requested, because they might learn about our capacity and say, well, we want 40 gig of bandwidth by using one of the existing vendors. It would cost us, I don't know, I would say $20,000 a month, and we cannot pay that. We can pay less than that if you can provide us. And then we will look into it and see if it's possible. But that's really case by case, but it's not possible or feasible or sustainable to do it for small businesses or residents.
Is that it for your presentation?
Yeah,
and I know there are lots of questions, so we'll start with Councilor Klein.
I wanted to ask with the current presidential administration and the new chairman of the FCC and the possibility of deregulation of all kinds of, you know, bandwidth speeds and all of the stuff that's kind of coming down the pike in terms of doing away with net neutrality, I'm just wondering if that will actually has the potential to affect. I don't understand enough technologically about how fiber works versus broadband versus, could it potentially affect the prices that we're looking at to keep the speeds at the rates that we need? Just what the changes that are happening at the federal administrative level, I'm wondering how it could affect us.
Yeah, it's a very good question, because the reason why I mentioned before that in the last 3-4 years, there has been a trend to lower the cost of fiber and bandwidth everywhere. One of the reasons for that is basically because the federal government has been encouraging the use of bandwidth for many reasons, including education, and it's been actually, I would say, at least the last 2 years, I think that investment on bandwidth from the federal government, it can be counted on billions, maybe $5-10 billion, to ensure that the cost come down. Because one of the things that makes the in this kind of market to make the pricing come down is because of offer versus demand. So before, the demand was huge, the offering was very small, and that would make the price very high. With the all these projects like MBI is not the only project that the federal government funded in the last few years. There's been multiple of them in every state. And besides that, the E-rate basically included new regulations to be more, to make more services eligible for E-rate discount. And that actually has had the effect of getting the pricing down. Under the new administration, we can expect that slow down a little bit, or even come to a point that goes back maybe 5 years in terms of the investment. And we have seen some signals of that already happening. What it could happen actually is that it will make the pricing plateau a little bit instead of coming down the way it was. So the trend will change in the future, might change. I cannot say that. That's a hard question on that way. And that could actually have an impact on the services that are available in the city in the future versus what is seen so far.
But what about the differential in speeds? Will we have to pay more in order to ensure the same level of speed?
So the pricing is being like coming down maybe 50% in the last 2 years, in the level of services that we are talking. The trend was, if you ask experts in the market 6 months ago, they would say that will continue. Every year would be a 25 to 50% price change. With the new environment, that might stop a little bit, and it would be more stable in the sense of not going down. So the pricing might remain the same for a while, but I don't think it will go up. It will remain the same, which means it will not be as affordable as it needs to be, because it's still not on the price that it should be.
But other questions? Antonio, I know, thank you for this, and in fact, actually, we've been floating balloons, and I do know that nationally there were a number of communities that offered municipal broadband, or were trying to in any event, and Chattanooga comes to mind. And as a result, they were able to expand their infrastructure to accommodate lots of software developers, lots of architectural design companies, film production companies that are bandwidth hogs, basically, and that I think it was like a gig up and a gig down was available to them. And I appreciate what you're saying here is now that's not practically feasible for us to try and do something like that here now. The concern of mine was, there was twofold. The reason I would like to see a municipal broadband was to attract businesses, to offer them faster upload and download speeds, but also was the digital divide. Because as you said, the price is still out of reach for some households. And as a result, given the ubiquity of internet access for other kids in school, for instance, the only place they can access a lot of this stuff is in schools. They can't go home. And in fact, actually, people who have less means are actually doing it in a very expensive way. They're doing paying data charges on their phones. And so, in my socialist tendencies, I wanted to at least hold out the hope of a possibility of a municipal broadband that would offer a sliding scale and make it accessible to all and thereby create a ubiquity among all class structures to have internet access, which I think at this point now in this, in our history, even though we seem to be going backwards, but at least at this point, it seems that it is an essential utility. It's as essential as electricity was when it was first introduced, and then it's as essential as water in many respects. So, and I do understand what you're describing here, that we're working more like with the camel's nose under the tent rather than doing some one massive project that renovates the whole infrastructure here, fibering up the whole city, and then offering a municipal broadband at reasonable and competitive rates. It's not even close to practical, I guess, is what I'm hearing. Mm-hmm. But I do like the prospect of, offering someone a service that might not otherwise be available through a private concern to areas that are adjacent to the I-loop. So there's that little shining hope of optimism. The mayor seems to want to say something.
Yeah, I wanted to say that I think that I've also looked at the Chattanooga model and little Chattanooga. I mean, I think we have the potential because of where the INET runs, which runs through and around both of our sort of central business areas, that we do have that potential to leverage it for potential economic development. It's going to take some planning. It's going to take, but I do see it as a value added that we can offer. I was talking to the folks at Click Workspace, and you can imagine they have bandwidth issues, and they actually are going through the process of buying fiber, having fiber run to their place and doing it with one of the commercial vendors. And they were talking about, is the city close? Are we at a point? And, we're not there yet, so you should sign your agreement. And don't wait for us, but I could certainly see the potential of us being able to offer that kind of service in certain areas. Places like Holyoke and Westfield, where they have their own utility and they're their own electric utility, and they've already got the city all wired and they own all the poles and they own all the infrastructure, it's a little bit different for them. We're not quite in that city. So we would have to do the capital outlay of wiring the entire city. There's poles, and we could use those poles, but it would still be a massive outlay to be able to do that. And we have some other capital needs in the city right now that I think.
Right, and as Antonio said, the
competing with Comcast would be very difficult. Once we did all that, would we be able to offer a price that would be competitive?
Yeah, and the return on investment would be a very long distance hope.
But I do agree with you, and I think that's one of the promising things, the whole idea of this one gig and up, like being able to offer that kind of service to people. And I think it would also have the effect, which is probably having in Chattanooga, of driving down prices among private providers when you have somebody in the game that's doing that. So,
well, as Councilor Klein pointed out, a big game changer in the fact that if the FCC starts to pare back and pull back regulations, first of all, Comcast and other ISPs essentially are allowed to have regional monopolies that are sanctioned by the federal government, and at the same time, so they provide offsets. That's why they're heavily regulated. It's why people are watching us on community access television, because Comcast is obliged to subsidize that. They're constantly pushing to try and get themselves relieved of those onerous pressures from the federal government. And I see a very accommodating federal government now that might buy Comcast or Verizon's argument to say that it is a competitive field and we no longer have to be beholden to the federal government for these things. So that would have. And then the issue of net neutrality is a separate issue, which is giving priority speed rates for certain commercial enterprises, whereas things that actually are more useful would be given low priority on on speed access. So, I mean, it's kind of a, as you pointed out, it's kind of a cloudy future as far as this goes. Pricing, however, you're right. I have noted that there's been a substantial drop in bandwidth costs. Still not to the point where it allows access to bridge the digital divide. And also, given the climbing desire of businesses to increase their bandwidth for a multitude of reasons, not the least of which is just even run a point of sale system or something like that. I mean, I can see where that would be appealing and wouldn't make us necessarily competitive with Comcast. Comcast, actually, I know in the past when other communities have discussed going to municipal broadband, they basically lowballed them to death. They just dropped their rates down and let whatever city that put up that upfront investment just die on the vine trying to make their costs. So I understand the terrain. I actually like the fact that we're investigating a transition of sorts. It's not with the same fanfare that, say, Greenfield or Leverett would have when Leverett went to a municipal broadband service too. But at the same time, at least we do have something to hold out. And I do hope that we do continue in this, as the mayor has stated, the investigation, exploration, and investment in bolstering and expanding our capacity to deliver broadband. So,
yeah, I would like to add to what the mayor said, that there is hope that as we continue the process of doing the master plan, we engage in conversations with individuals and institutions in the community, whether they are potential partners. I know that, you know, in my conversations with providers, there's always the desire to partner with communities, you know, with cities that have the infrastructure that we have, in order for them to reach out to communities that they cannot. Like, you know, I mentioned several providers that are here in Northampton. They are in the center of Northampton, but they are not in Florence. Right. For them to get to Florence, we are talking a huge investment, six figures investment. But if we become one way or the other a provider in the future, I'm pretty sure that those providers will come here and knock the door to start doing partnerships to be able to get there. So they need basically just a few miles of fiber to get to where they need to be and then provide services there. So that's, and as the mayor mentioned, there's new businesses, and, you know, my dream would be that, you know, people come to Northampton because there is technology and there is availability of bandwidth for them, and they can put some new STEM-based businesses here. And, you know, I'm pretty sure as we continue, I just want to warn everybody, and maybe I'm a little too aware of this, but that it's not going to be a quick process. It's going to be a slow process, but I think that we should, and I know the mayor is very engaged on continuing the process to study the next steps and possibilities.
I mean, bandwidth consumption is evolving as we speak. I mean, where cable services are waning as people stream a lot of their content now, and that's bandwidth, and that trend is going to increase, it seems. And so as people cut the wire, as it were. But so and I just also want to say thank you very much because of your vision so far, and despite our snafus today with the presentation, that which actually I think humanizes it, but it's the it's made a big difference. Your presence in this department has made a big difference.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Any other comments or questions, Ventonio?
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Okay. Let me, as I go back, okay, now we're back on the agenda. We come up to the consent agenda, and contained in the consent agenda is item 17.241. That's to approve appointments to various committees. And all appointments received a positive recommendation from the Committee on City Services on February 6, 2017. First off, we have the Human Rights Commission, Booker Bush of 119 Pine Street in Florence. This is a term for the Human Rights Commission to start January 2017, expiring June 2020. And this is replacing the expired term of Douglas Ross. And on the Arts Council, Kathy Murray of 50 Laurel Park. Term starting January 2017, expiring June 2020. And this is replacing the expired term of Jean Paul Matinsky. And the Planning Board, Samuel Taylor, 245 North Street in Northampton. This is a term to run from January 2017 to June 2020. This is replacing the expired term of Al Neal. And then finally, on the Zoning Board, Maureen Scanlon of 197 Nonotuck Street in Florence. The term to run from January 2017 to June 2020. And this is replacing the expired term of Sanford Wild. That's okay. Also, this is to approve the minutes of February 2nd, 2017. Excuse me?
You still have, for the Zoning Board, you have Maureen Scanlon. I didn't hear you read that one.
No, I'm sorry, you're right. Zoning Board was Maureen Scanlon of 197 Nonotuck Street, and that's also a term from January 2017 to June 2020. That's thank you. I guess, okay. Also to approve the minutes of February 2nd, 2017, the City Council meeting. Is there a motion for?
Second.
Okay. All those in favor of the consent agenda, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay. We're going to recess for Finance Committee meeting. Councilor Murphy, who normally chairs this, is away with permission, and in his place will be Councilor Carney will be presiding.
Okay, thank you. We will begin with a roll call, please.
Councilor Carney?
Present.
Councilor LaBarge?
Present.
Councilor Nash?
Present.
And if we can have a motion to approve the minutes of the February 2nd meeting?
Second.
Those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? None. Good. Okay. So that takes us to the first financial order, which is upon recommendation of the mayor, 17.253, an order to authorize intermunicipal agreement with PVPC. Ordered that, whereas Mass General Law Chapter 40, Section 4A, allows for joint operation of public activities among governmental units, and whereas Mass General Law Chapter 40, Section 4A, requires that such intergovernmental agencies be approved in a city by the City Council and the Mayor, and whereas the City of Northampton provides services to and shares services with other municipalities, therefore, pursuant to Mass General Law Chapter 40, Section 4A, the City of Northampton is authorized to enter into an intermunicipal agreement with the Pioneer Valley Planning Commission and other municipalities in the region for PVPC to provide technical assistance for online mobile integrated data collection and mapping application services to meet requirements of the new EPA Stormwater MS4 General Permit for a period not to exceed 5 years. And I'll ask the mayor.
Sure. So this is basically your approving an intermunicipal agreement. Northampton and a number of other municipalities in the PVPC service area in the Connecticut River area want to basically work together on a project to develop some of the training and some of the infrastructure and some of the mapping that we're all going to have to do individually to comply with the new stormwater permits that requirements of the new stormwater permit. So this is basically an effort where we're going to be working. PVPC is going to be sort of the lead agency, and there's a working group with representatives from the different communities, and we're going to be developing some of the mapping software, compliance, training materials, and other things that we're all going to need. So it's a good example of how the regional planning organization can sort of serve, you know, a regional model like they've done for other things, you know, gaming and transit and all kinds of other roles. So that's what this is about. And in order to enter into one of those agreements, you know, like Valley Bike Share, we need to have you approve it, the intermunicipal agreement.
Any questions, councilors? Motion?
There's a question there.
Oh, yes.
Just, you have to put it on the floor first.
Is there a motion to put it on the floor, please? Second? Okay, councilor?
I'm just curious, because it's, you know, it's a regional requirement, but it's a statewide requirement, too. I mean, seems, you know, good that there's a regional effort, but seems also curious there's not sort of a statewide effort to provide, you know, joint preparation for a requirement that we all...
But then it wouldn't be an unfunded mandate.
There you go.
It's actually an unfunded federal mandate, in fairness, because we're one of the few states that actually directly, this is a permit directly from EPA, but yes.
And the other regions doing the same thing, I guess?
It's possible that other planning agencies like are probably doing that, but okay. Yeah. You know, this is something that we're all having to deal with, and so it just made sense to try to do it collectively.
Absolutely makes
yeah,
sense.
Yeah, so yeah, no.
Okay. Yeah.
No technical assistance
comment
is being offered, just a deadline and a new set of requirements that we have to comply with.
Yeah. Any other questions?
Is it only, does this actually only affect coverage of communities abutting the Connecticut River, or is it the entire watershed?
You know, it's Connecticut River because it's communities that you know, discharge into the Connecticut
right, okay.
River,
so it's
which is part of what our permit is. So it would be all of the communities that have, in order to do those discharges, all of our stormwater and wastewater permits, you know, have to be in compliance. So that's why it's sort of the tie to the Connecticut River.
Right. No, I mean, just wondering if upstream
yep.
folks bear some onus here too, but
I suppose. Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, I'll ask if there's a motion to send this with a positive recommendation to full council.
Second.
And a second. Okay, all those in favor, say aye. No? None opposed?
And I did want to say that I think there was a request, I don't know if it made it on the agenda, when we go to the main meeting to get two readings, we were a little late to joining this grant, and we want to stay on target, this joint effort, and we want to stay on target. We kind of missed the deadline, but they said they would let us get into it, so that's why we're asking for two readings.
You're asking for,
to approve.
Okay, that's not noted here, but yeah.
Okay.
That motion carried, and we'll move on to 17.254. In order to authorize that premiums received upon sale of bonds used to pay project costs shall reduce the amount authorized to be borrowed by any such premium so applied. Ordered that the city votes to supplement each prior order of this council that authorizes the borrowing of money to pay costs of capital projects to provide that, in accordance with Chapter 44, Section 20 of the General Laws, the premium received by the city upon the sale of any bonds or notes thereunder, less any such premium applied to the payment of the costs of issuance of such bonds or notes, may be applied to pay project costs, and the amount authorized to be borrowed for each such project shall be reduced by the amount of any such premium so applied. I'll ask if there's a motion to put this on the floor. And second.
Okay. So as you may, as you know, that whenever we do bonding, we typically get language that comes from our bond council, which is sort of legalese, and we approve that as part of the bond authorization because we're required to do that before we can do the bond issuance. So on November 7th, many of you know, the state passed the Municipal Modernization Act, and one of the hundreds and hundreds of changes about the Municipal Modernization Act was the treatment of premiums related to bond sales and how they needed to be treated, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And so going forward, when we do that language from the bond council, it will include language very similar to this about premiums. The problem is some communities like Northampton, had already authorized bonds and hadn't issued them yet. So we actually have two bonds that you've already authorized. You've already passed language under the old language, but we haven't actually issued the bonds yet. There is the for Pulaski Park and for the River Road Retaining Wall project that you've passed authorizations for. So the solution that DOR has found for this is that that the authorization to use that option should be included in the original legislative vote authorizing the loan, but of course we can't go back in time and do that, but may also be included by an amendment of the loan authorization that is voted before the sale. So we haven't sold these two, we haven't gone out to sell these two, so our bond council has asked you to adopt this language, which will be applied to those that have already happened, and then going forward, we'll just they will amend their language to account for this new premium provision in the Municipal Modernization Act. So it's more of a technical corrective kind of a thing to comply with the law that went into effect, you know, in between the process of our authorizing a bond and actually selling the bond.
Any other questions? Is there a motion to send this with a positive recommendation?
Please send it to City Council for recommendation.
And second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? None. Abstentions? That motion carries. And item 17.255. An order to authorize payment of a previous year bill incurred by the Health Department. Be it ordered that the Council authorize payment of a prior fiscal year bill, fiscal year 2016, in the amount of $400 to Overdoes Lifeline for work associated with the Health Department's Opioid Task Force grant. I think that means that should say Overdose Lifeline.
Of course, they're almost synonymous.
So. Yeah. Is
that's
there a motion to put
that's
this
a Scrivener's
floor?
Error. Yeah.
So put this on the floor.
Second.
Okay. And I assume this is pretty self-evident.
Yeah, it's actually part of our part of the opioid task force, and it's a bill for a training program that was $400, and again it didn't make it in time for the fiscal year, so we need authorization to pay that bill. And it'll be paid out of the opioid task force grant, which we administer, and we are the lead agency for, and the staff works out of our health department.
Very good. Is there a motion to put this with a positive recommendation? Questions.
Mayor, how did they make out with this task force?
The task force is going really well. Actually, they're going to be. I think they're coming up on their 2-year anniversary. Pretty soon, and they're going to be doing kind of a celebration event to talk about some of the things that they've been doing. But they've been doing a lot of work in all the communities. You may have seen recently that they're sponsoring Narcan training, community Narcan training in a number of different communities, I think including there'll be one in Northampton. I want to say on the 21st, but they have a great website and social media presence, and so they're doing a lot of that work. They're doing a lot of work training police and district attorneys, and you know, you may have also recently they opened sort of in a limited fashion the recovery center. That's right, the recovery center. Thank you. I was losing it, which is based on the model that's been successful up in Franklin County, which is sort of run a model that's run by people who are in recovery as a place that people can come to and work on issues together and look for jobs and do all kinds of other things. So they've been doing a lot of work. Obviously, the district attorney's office has been part of it, and the grant still has more years of funding. And unfortunately, the problem, as we know, continues to be a serious issue in Massachusetts and Western Massachusetts, Southern Vermont, and frankly throughout, you know, New England and the country.
Mr. Mayor, can I add something to that?
Um,
No, technically, no, it's not allowed.
Yeah. Technically, I wasn't on the agenda to discuss the Hope Coalition, or I would have prepared for that. I wasn't able to prepare to do a full coalition
presentation. That's the reason it's not on the agenda, so that and also at this point, all the conversation starts from this lineup. So. It'll be going to City Services in May, where also discussion can happen there. Sorry.
Any other questions? Is there a motion to send it with a positive recommendation?
Second.
Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? None? And abstentions? That motion carries. And we have, upon recommendation of the mayor, item 17.256, an order to authorize the appropriation of funds to perform job classification and compensation study. Ordered that $70,500 be appropriated from the fiscal year 17 general fund undesignated fund balance free cash to engage the Edward J. Collins Center for Public Management at the University of Massachusetts Boston to perform a classification and compensation study of select represented and non-represented city job titles. The Collins Center shall also be engaged to perform a concurrent review of human resource policies and procedures to ensure alignment with said classification system, current best practices, and all applicable state and federal employment laws. Is there a motion to put this on the floor?
Second.
And seconded? Okay. And Mayor, any?
Again, this is an item that we have discussed in executive session, so I don't have much to add about this order or the next order.
Okay. Any other questions, considerations? Is there a motion to send this forward with a?
Second.
Moved and seconded to send with a positive recommendation. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. None opposed and no abstentions. Carries. Now we have, upon the recommendation of the mayor, an order, item 17.257, an order to transfer funds for salaries. The following fiscal year 2017 budgetary transfers for salary are hereby made. And I'll read each. These are all for sale. These all come from the reserve for personnel, which is an amount of $346,872. And that total amount is for the following departments, all for salaries. In City Council, an amount of $746. In the Mayor's Office, an amount of $28,118. In the Auditor Office, $16,970. The assessors, $2,618. The treasurer collector, $12,446. Human resources, $22,794. Information technology, $25,350. City clerk, $3,357. Planning and sustainability, $12,791. Central services, $11,550. Police department, $129,836. Fire Department, $5,519. Public Safety Dispatch, $5,815. Building Inspectors, $16,108. Engineering, $3,730. DPW Administration, $2,709. Highways Department, $14,619. Cemetery, $2,273. DPW Parks and Recreation, $3,376. Board of Health, $4,630. Council on Aging, $13,302. Veterans, $3,327. Recreation, $4,888. And for that total of $346,872. Is there a motion to put this on the floor?
Sure. I'll make the motion.
Second.
Okay.
Again, this is money I'm asking you to transfer from existing monies that have already been appropriated. And again, I've discussed this with you in executive session.
Okay, is there any other discussion? I'll ask if there's a motion to send this with positive recommendation to the full council?
I'll make a motion.
And seconded? Okay. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? None? No abstentions? And that carries. Okay, and we have, upon the recommendation of Councillor Ryan R. O'Donnell, 17.244, an ordinance to establish a minimum wage for municipal employees. An ordinance of the City of Northampton, Massachusetts, be it ordained by the City Council of the City of Northampton, in City Council assembled as follows. Section 1, that the Code of Ordinances be amended by adding the following. Section 5-6, Fair Minimum Wage Ordinance. No executive or legislative branch employee of the City of Northampton shall be paid at a rate less than the minimum wage set forth in the Massachusetts Minimum Fair Wage Law, Massachusetts General Law, Chapter 151, Section 1. Nothing herein shall be construed to apply to any wages established pursuant to an existing collective bargaining agreement or to the compensation of any elected official. Is there a motion to put this on the floor?
Second.
And seconded. And turn to the councillor.
Yep, thank you. I'll just explain, give you the basics of why I would like to do this and how it works. As you probably know, the federal minimum wage is $7.25. It's been that way since 2009. In Massachusetts, we have our own state minimum wage, which is always at least 50 cents higher than that, and currently it's $11. It's $11 as a result of a bill the legislature passed, I think in 2014, which increased the state minimum wage $1 a year up until this year. So January of 2017 was the last increment of that increase. And to give you some flavor of this, in the words of the Mass General Law that creates the state minimum wage, is Chapter 151, which is cited in the ordinance. A wage of less than $11 per hour in any occupation, as defined in this chapter, shall conclusively be presumed to be oppressive and unreasonable. So very strong words about the need to have a certain minimum wage paid to every profession. The wrinkle for cities and towns to consider is that this statute has been interpreted not to apply to municipal employees. This was decided by an opinion from the Attorney General in 2002. And you may have the opinion in your packets, but the opinion basically cites another statute in the law that essentially does set forth the authority of cities and towns to set these rules, including a maximum and minimum wage. And so in the words of the Attorney General at the time, that statute and the minimum wage statute evidenced the legislature's clear intent to establish different wage and hour rules for municipal employees and to exclude them from coverage under the state minimum wage laws, which apply to private employers. So that's the situation that we're in. And when I learned that, I was pretty shocked. It was surprising to me that all municipal employees are essentially not covered by a state minimum wage. In Northampton, as a practical matter, this mayor, and I think previous mayors as well, have done a good job to make sure that our employees do get paid a minimum wage. What I'd like to do with this ordinance is close what I see as a major loophole in the state law and codify Northampton's practice. So if you will, bring a little bit of Northampton to the state. And that's what this ordinance would do. It would require that, it would take our practice and codify it. So future councils and future mayors would have to abide by a minimum wage that was fair. because everyone, you know, whether you work in the private sector or the public sector, deserves to be paid fairly. And that's a principle that this ordinance would codify. I'll just explain a couple. The last sentence is a few exceptions to that. It makes it clear that this ordinance is not going to apply to existing collective bargaining agreements. I think it's a practical matter. I don't think we have any collective bargaining agreements that include wages that are below the minimum wage. But I think that's out of an abundance of caution to ensure we don't have to open up any old collective bargaining agreements. And that came as a result of conversations I had with the mayor and also the solicitor. And it also clarifies that this ordinance doesn't apply to elected officials. So if you've been tallying the amount of hours you spend a week doing constituent work, you can stop doing that because you will not be guaranteed a minimum wage with this ordinance. The other thing to point out is that the statute that gives us the authority to do that, well, first of all, it's making clear that this doesn't apply to elected officials is a little bit redundant because the state law already makes that clear, that we can't set a minimum wage for elected officials. But it also makes clear that we don't have the authority to set a minimum wage for employees that are essentially controlled by the school committee. So that's why this ordinance says the legislative branch, in other words, Ms. Powers, I think, essentially. Yeah, the legislative branch is sitting there before us, and the executive branch, but not the school committee. So those are the exceptions. But I think this is an important principle to codify for the future. So that's my explanation. I'm happy to answer any questions if there are any.
Any questions, Councillor?
Yes. School committee, they would be fully responsible, not us councillors, to say this is what you're going to do. They would be fully responsible on this minimum wage.
Yep, and in the superintendent of schools, actually in the last budget message, wrote that they've achieved that. All their employees in the school department are paid a minimum wage. So it's the only thing is we can't, as a city council, set rules for them to follow with regards to their employees. We could get into the habit of requesting the information be given to us before we vote on the budget. Please tell us, you know. But yeah, we can't set it in an ordinance. So.
Any other questions, Councilor?
Following up on that, has the school committee actually codified this, though, other than the fact that they've met the standards?
No, we
haven't.
Okay.
Any more questions? Okay, is there a motion to send this with
a
positive recommendation to the full city council and seconded? All those in favor?
Aye.
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 None opposed, no abstentions. And that brings us up to our committee study request. And I know it was the chair's wish to have discussion here in the full council meeting to give everybody an opportunity to participate in this. The request, which was to just trying to get to the to discuss and propose a plan to increase citizen participation and engagement in the city council's budget hearings for fiscal year 2018. So I'll ask councilors, any?
Well, I've been thinking about this. Last night I was part of the annual Democratic caucus over at Smith Folk, and the turnout was amazing. For the Ward 3 caucus, we had over 30 people attend, and I would say 20 of those faces I had not seen in public forums before, and that they were enthusiastic and engaged and passionate and looking for ways to be involved. And one of the themes that I've heard is that people are concerned about what's going on at the federal level and how it's going to play out here at home in town. And that that I, you know, we've talked about the budget reflects our values and the numbers. And I think that people would be very interested in hearing how our budget is protecting those values and how that is reflected in the budget. And I think that people would, you know, they would come to budget presentations and be involved in the discussion, you know, looking at those particular things. So I would, you know, put it out to the mayor, you know, in terms of putting together presentations. A few weeks ago, we had the the overview of the budget, and that you pointed to a particular, there was a grant maybe that might be affected. But that kind of information, I think, would be really interesting to know. I think that our budget, you know, based on the information that I received, that we're actually pretty well protected. But at the same time, I think that people need to hear that and they need to see it. So that would be my suggestion, how to get that into the discussion.
Counselor?
I know we've been having a serious problem of having people and residents attending our budget hearings. Maybe possibly have a budget hearing up at JFK School, so that way it accommodates the Leeds area, Florence area, maybe at Northampton High School, because parking is really a problem. That I do know. Many people have complained to me that they just don't want to come down here. They prefer being up at the school at JFK. It's so much, and it's feasibly easier for them for driving and so forth like that. But I have noticed too a significant change in our budget hearings. Nobody coming. And I know, Councilor Dwight, you also had concerns about that. We've heard you stress that many times sitting behind that microphone. And it is, it's a big problem, and we need to reach out. I think we need to show the transparency. And I think the mayor himself to do the presentations, and I have to agree with Jim, I think some of the things he said is very, very valuable. People actually want to know, you know, about the federal level and the money here in this city also. Are we overspending or not? Because I heard that also. What's the difference, Counselor? They just keep constantly spending money. So we need to show people, no, we're not doing that. The money we're spending is for reasons.
You know, actually, the level of engagement of the budget, of course, is obviously dictated by a variety of things. We had more folks showing up for budget discussions when an override was looming, obviously. It's what triggers a sense of urgency. Then usually afterwards we have subsequent conversations when budget cuts are applied, and they may even include possible layoffs and things like that. This is when people start to participate. This is one of the least sexy things you could have possibly imagined, you know, even talking about doing your home budget, and no one really queues up for that for a fun night out. So I understand they're trying to make the appeal and a larger appeal, and this is what Councilor O'Donnell and I were asking, was this, what actually structural things can we do to at least make it more available and accessible? Actually, the chair, I like the fact that he's decided to do this on the night he's not here, but the chair of finance actually made a suggestion to me that I actually think's not a bad one. I don't know if it'll work, but it's to structurally change the way we do the hearings. In the past, what we've done is we sort of cherry-picked our various departments based on whatever. Some of them really don't have much in the way of
a greater relevance when we, I mean, the big ones, you know, public safety, schools, and the like, those make sense. The smaller departments at that point, it's, unless you want to get in the weeds, or unless there's some personal amicus, which has happened in the past, really, no one pays any attention to those, and I can understand. They're not huge budget items, and they're not of particular interest, and we ask department heads to come in, and they give their presentation to the choir. We already know what they do and what they're doing, what they're charged with. So given the fact there's a public discussion about public issues, that we maybe restructure the format, and maybe it, I don't disagree. I think the idea of doing it in various, doing a JFK at least, would give an opportunity. We have done that in the past too, and we were very lonely sitting up there by ourselves, talking amongst ourselves. But it's, and the thing that I've always tried to impress on the public is that, by the way, this is the most essential service that the council provides. This is what you run for, is to provide oversight over the budget. Does it conform with our moral demands? Because it is a moral document. Is the mayor crafting a budget that conforms with our sense of the constituents' wishes? So it can get lost into political battles and infighting and stuff that really doesn't necessarily have any relevance to the budget and how it's applied. But it's more about targeting people and or things. We haven't experienced that lately. That's good. And maybe that's why it's boring. It's why people don't show up. If you don't have slap fights, what's the point of showing up? So I think Councilor O'Donnell and I knew that when we asked this, that in the asking it was difficult to, you know, short of offering face painting and balloons, I'm really not quite sure what you can do to attract people to come to participate in the discussion, because this is what we're doing. We're asking them to participate, because we'll ask our questions, but by and large, we actually possess at least a probably more in-depth understanding in some of the issues that we're talking about, whereas the public might not, and this is the public's opportunity to express their opinions, to ask their questions, to see if, to them, if this document conforms with their sense of what we should be prioritizing.
Yes, Councilor?
I too was impressed at the last night's meeting at Smith Folk of the Democratic caucuses, at the enthusiasm. Ward 2, there must have been 45 people at the Ward 2 caucus. And one actually stood up, and because I was encouraging these people, besides getting involved in Democratic Party politics, to get involved in councils and boards and commissions and come to city council meetings. And one person said, I've been to a city council meeting, and you know what the city needs? It needs larger chambers, because the meeting I was at was just overflowing and standing room only. And I pointed out to him that was one of the hot button issues. Come to the budget hearings, why don't you? And we hardly need larger chambers for that. But I think Councilor Nash is on the right track. I think we need to we need some hooks to engage people. And I think we could do hearings and say come learn what is the likely impact on the city budget of Northampton's sanctuary city status. We happen to know that it's probably not too much of an impact, but nevertheless, it's a question on people's minds. And what is the effect on Northampton's budget of steady or declining state aid to our school system? What do the bond rating agencies think about Northampton's fiscal management? What is the impact on Northampton's budget of unfunded mandates from the state and from the federal governments? And if we really wanted to be provocative to get a little attention, what does this budget say about the likelihood of a possible future need for an override? I think we could put some kind of juicy questions out there that are on some people's minds and that are that really get more to the meaty issues and the values part of the budget than just the nuts and bolts that's boring. So I think there's some messaging in the way that we publicize our hearings that could stimulate some interest.
Councilor O'Donnell and then Councilor Sharer.
Well, first of all, I'm glad to hear the council from Ward 2 is showing fiscal restraint and not wanting to build a larger council chamber, because that would add a large item to the budget.
No, I drew the line.
Yeah, that would bring people out.
That would really go over.
But actually, I tend to agree with Councilor Nash and Councilor Bidwell, and just the general idea that, in a way, we need to do a better job of communicating what's going on with the process generally. What we can do, what we can't do, and what the interests people have in the process, what they are. And those are the hooks, if you will, to get people to come. So there's that kind of general work. And I think in addition to that, I think we should also remember we should include the capital program, the five-year capital program, as an important element of the discussion. Because I think for a lot of people, that may be what they're thinking about. I mean, everyone, you know, there might be some people who want to defund certain programs here and there. I mean, I know there are, actually. But I think by and large, the services that people get are valued in the city. And a lot of the interest has to do with, well, how much will you spend on road paving? You know, what are the infrastructure upgrades you're going to make? You know, certainly the what we anticipate spending in the wastewater treatment plant, things like that, that don't sound glamorous. But when you start talking about the physical, building blocks of the city, things that are tangible that people know, I think those are also important to include in the discussion. I would also just say, I think there's just some basic notification practices we can adopt. I don't know when have we ever publicized our hearings on social media? I mean, I'm not sure. Have we ever gone back, you know, to our own, have the ward councilors gone and tried to actively recruit people to come? If they did, could there be a process whereby they solicit questions in advance? I don't know. Could we receive questions online and kind of sort through them and pose them during the process? But I guess that's a long way of saying, you know, obviously the budget is more than just a series of line items for expenditures and revenues. It is a process, and the public is sort of, is an essential part of that process, but perhaps has not been included by the council as much as they should be, not for any nefarious reason. I just think it's something we can do better at. That's my initial take on it. I'm not sure I have all the answers, or any of us do, but that's my initial take. So thanks.
Councilor Sharer. First, I want to make sure that everyone knows that Ward 4 also had a huge turnout. As anything, in the last few months, it's that competing about crowd size really matters. So I want you all to know that. It's
sad.
I just have sort of a procedural note as a veteran of the committee study request process. It's a request, and the committee needs to accept the request. It's not necessarily like a hard thing that you need to have a vote on, but I think the committee does need to accept or not accept the request. Since we're having the discussion, I think the committee is likely going to accept, but I think it's...
I'm actually kind of a last-minute stand-in for the chair, so I don't know whether it was the intention, in fact, to have the discussion in his absence. It's just that it appeared on the agenda, so I assume it wasn't on there. So. So I don't know whether we want to postpone discussion until the chair is back at the next meeting.
I make that motion to postpone it until the chair of finance comes back.
Sure, I second.
Okay, moved and seconded to postpone the discussion till the next meeting.
So we have to take back what everybody's already said?
No, I don't think so. I think that's done.
He can read minutes.
To be continued. Is there a better term than postponement? To be continued at the next...
Continued.
Sounds good.
I make that recommendation.
Okay. To be continued at the next session. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. None opposed. And I'll ask if there's a final motion.
Make a motion.
Second.
To adjourn. Second. Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, we convene back in regular session, and just by way of explanation to folks watching at home who are confused about what the hell is going on, what we do is we actually have a committee meeting within a committee meeting. What you just experienced was the Finance Committee meeting, and they make recommendations, and then it comes back to us, and we're going to vote on the item. Before we go to that, I do want to point out, relevant to the last discussion in Finance Committee meeting, was that the Gazette gives us free advertising. We do post it as a public notice. Also, if you go to the city's website, the presentation that we had given by the mayor, in fact, Mary Cerez of Mass Live has written a couple of articles about it, and it's a very interesting document that the mayor has prepared. It's graphically designed to be more accessible, not doesn't get lost in the weeds with... Yeah, it's a video. So, but... Yeah, and it's got colors too, so it's really, but it actually, it also provides context, which is very important, and I think people, you know, if for nothing else, just to feel relatively good about our prospects, because just not to give too much away, we have a AAA bond rating, which is the highest in of all the comparison cities, and the reason for that is because of our really sound and progressive, when I say ours, like I had anything to do with, this is the executive branch, fiduciary oversight here. And now the council deserves some credit because we do approve these budgets, but it's worth checking out. I mean, it's, you know, it's not Gilmore Girls, but it's actually really worth paying attention to, given the conversation we just had. Well, it's not.
It's true, it's not.
Okay. All right, so now we're going back to the regular meeting. In the financial orders, some of them, many of these you just heard, but we're going to start with item 17.255. That's an order to authorize payment of a previous year bill for the Board of Health. This is the first reading. I'll accept a motion. Put it on the floor.
Second.
Okay. Any further discussion on this item? Okay, roll call, please.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy. I'm sorry, Councilor Nash.
Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Sherr.
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell.
Yes.
All right, that passes in first reading. Next item is 17.256. Is in order to authorize the appropriation of funds to perform job classification and compensation studies. Is a request for two readings.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion's made and second. Any further discussion on this item? Okay.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Councilor Nash.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Sherr.
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
I'll accept a motion to suspend the rules.
Move to approve.
Okay, move to suspense. Second.
Something like that. Okay. Any discussion on the suspension of rules? And what we're doing is we're suspending the rules to allow for a second reading tonight because of the urgency of this particular item. So any other discussion on suspension? All those in favor of suspending rules, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? I'll accept another motion.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motions are made and seconded for a second reading. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Councilor Nash.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Sherr.
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes. That passes in second reading. Item 17.257. That's an order to transfer funds for salaries. And also, a request for two readings on this one.
Move to
approve.
Second.
Okay, motion's made and seconded. It's on the floor. Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Councilor Nash.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Sherr.
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Suspend the rule.
Motion made to suspend rules and seconded. Any discussion on the suspension of rules? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? I'll accept a motion.
Move approval.
Second.
Okay. Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Nash.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Sher.
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor LeBarge.
Yes.
Okay. That passes in second reading, and I should just point out to folks who are wondering why there is no discussion, the fact that you saw some of the discussion already, and on these other two items, this has been discussed in executive session. Now we move on to orders. 17.253, an order to authorize intermunicipal agreement with the PVPC. Pioneer Valley Planning Commission. There's been a request for two readings on this item as well.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Any further discussion on this? Roll call, please.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Sher.
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor LeBarge.
Yes.
Councilor Nash.
Yes.
All right, that passes in first reading.
Suspend rules.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. To suspend rules. Any discussion on the suspension of rules? All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Any abstentions? I'll accept a motion.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded to have a second reading. Any other discussion? Roll call.
Councilor Shira.
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor LeBarge.
Yes.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
This is in second reading. Item 17.254. This is an order to authorize the premiums received upon the sale of bonds used to pay project costs shall reduce the amount authorized to be borrowed by any such premium so applied.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Any discussion on this? Roll call, please.
Councilor Bidwell.
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LeBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Nash?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Shira?
Yes.
Okay, that passes in first reading. The next reading, the next vote on that item will be in our first meeting in March. Item 17.245, that's an order to accept Mass General Law, Chapter 44S, I mean Section 53 F and 3/4.
It's a good section.
It's
section.
There's a name that's so accessible. Put it on a bumper sticker. Yeah. This is second reading.
Move to approve.
Any further discussion on this?
Did I get a second on that?
Was there a second?
Thank you.
Thank you. Yep. Any further discussion? 53 F 3/4.
Second
going
and
once, going twice. All right. Roll call, please.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LeBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Nash?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Shira?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Okay, that passes in second reading. Next up, item 17.244. This is an ordinance regarding fair minimum wage of the first reading. Accept a motion.
Move approval.
Second.
Further discussion on this item? I just want to say that, and it should go noted, that Councilor O'Donnell struggled with this for some time, and I appreciate his doggedness, because I do think this is, you're absolutely right. I think if we want, we once again have to walk the talk, and I think this more than appropriate, and I'm glad you worked it out.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks to the mayor and the solicitor for their
and I know as well. I know that there was actually no resistance, only a willingness to comply,
exactly, yeah,
but at the same time trying to figure out how to make it work.
And I hope it's an example of, you know, Northampton leading the way for other towns that might, quite honestly, might need this more than we do.
There are a few. Yeah.
Won't name names.
If you go to the mayor's budget report, he names names.
That's true.
Any further discussion on this item? Roll call for this, Pam, please.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LeBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Nash?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Shara?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
All right, that passes in first reading. Next time it will be visited is our first meeting in March. Item 17.250, this is an ordinance to add a new smart overlay district. This is for referral to the Committee on Legislative Matters. Is there a motion?
To refer.
To refer.
Motion's made and seconded. Councilor O'Donnell or Councilor, who wants to take it? Councilor Bidwell.
I'll second.
Well, it's been seconded.
Oh, I'm sorry.
So you're way ahead. Did you want to say something?
Yes, I want to say it.
Well, then you can do that too.
Pardon me. There's been some discussion about perhaps this being referred also to the Committee on Community Services, which has discussed other zoning related matters.
Community resources.
Community resources, I'm sorry. Yes.
Councilor Bidwell is making a request to add on to the referral to community resources. Is there
a second that?
Second on that? Okay. Councilor O'Donnell.
Just to that point, since we changed the rules, I believe we've had, well, zoning ordinances have to have a hearing by the council, and we put it into a committee for that purpose. And historically, we put it in the ordinance committee, which is now legislative matters. I believe in this term, we've had those hearings in both legislative matters and once, at a minimum, at least in community resources, which is set up as, you know, zoning and land use is one of the jurisdictions. So I just put that out there. I mean, it has to go to ordinance anyway because it's an ordinance, but it's a question of whether the Committee on Community Resources feels it's the appropriate body to have the hearing with the plan, probably with the planning board, I would imagine. So, I mean, it's on the agenda, but it's not like the council has made a decision on that. It's just more of a recommendation, so.
Right.
And if there's no appetite to change it, it's perfectly fine with me to have it in legislative matters. But since Councilor Bidwell brings it up, I mean, it is the jurisdiction of the Committee on Community Resources to do with land use, so.
It is also possible the two chairs could commiserate, consider a joint hearing.
Like a three-way hearing?
Yeah.
Is that the planning board?
Sort of.
Planning board.
Councilor Shara.
Because there's, for the thought that we might want to have this go to community resources, it's on the agenda for community resources for next week, but a hearing has not been announced for that. And
there's some timing requirements associated with
right.
it.
So,
and there's already a discussion in the works about planning having a joint hearing with legislative matters in March. So,
right.
I mean, that's already.
So I would be fine with having it come to community resources next week and then having the hearing in legislative matters.
That makes more sense since planning and mm-hmm. legislative right. matters do that typically for.
Okay. Councilor Nash?
So this particular zoning change has to do with a project that's being proposed by the Valley CDC for Bridge Street. And they're actually in the process of doing their outreach to the community. They met with the Ward 3 Association Board just this week. They haven't had a chance to meet with the principal of the school or the school community, that they're doing outreach with the abutters, and I'm helping them out with facilitating those discussions. And I think it's really important that those things happen before things go to a committee, because the idea, I've been talking about this with Laura and Joanne, the idea that getting people informed and up to speed on what the project is so that they're informed for when things do go to committee. I think going to community resources is a great idea. I don't think this outreach will be done by then. The next legislative matters, I think, is March 13th. And I was talking with Laura today about that would be a doable deadline in terms of getting the outreach done. And maybe that's a date where, committees could match up, you know, with that date in mind. So.
Councilor Shara?
I mean, that's even more reason to have the public hearing be in legislative matters. but I mean, would you have an objection with community resources discussing it on Tuesday?
No, I just, in terms of, I guess it could be discussed. I think that, but in terms of getting the word out to people to show up to provide feedback, I think that needs to be a few more weeks out.
What the public hearing would be for.
Right.
Yeah.
So for the purpose of community resources discussion, they'll be discussing probably not the neighborhood's reaction or response, but essentially the issues that are before them that would be appropriate for their oversight and review. So they wouldn't be mutually exclusive is what I'm saying, I don't think.
It's parallel processes.
Yeah. Right. It'd be a parallel process, exactly. The hearing's the more relevant and pertinent thing where the public has an opportunity to weigh in. And once they have a greater understanding of the project and or have a greater amplification of their questions, that would be the appropriate time to bring those up and wouldn't necessarily preclude or exclude what community resources does.
Okay.
I just wouldn't want to hold it up a little bit.
Yeah, I don't want to hold it up either. I just, in terms of doing, that, so that this particular process of making the zoning change, this is the time for public, this makes it the time for the public to be part of the discussion. Mm-hmm. Because once we finish with this, then it, the way it goes through the planning board is there's less opportunity for input. It goes to site plan. So then it's just kind of reviewing, what the project looks like, but it, site plan, that there's, the public won't have a lot of opportunity to change the proposal.
Should also be noted that community resources is a public meeting. If the public, they might not be able, they might not have answers to the questions that the public may have at that point, but there's also an opportunity at least to hear the description of what the overlay will be and an opportunity to hear about that. Right. Councilor Klein.
Do we have time to invite the mayor or somebody from the planning department to come and speak at the community resources meeting? Because I feel like we're going to need to have that kind of discussion with somebody who's a real expert in this.
A couple things. I don't know if we can describe tonight the things we're actually referring.
Right.
Since to start to get the word out about what these are. That would be one thing before we vote on this. And just a small thing, I would just like to extend this motion to the three zoning ordinances so we can refer all of them to the two committees.
Okay, so you
if that would be amenable, mm-hmm. if people would be amenable to that.
So what you're referring to is also the other one that's queued up for a referral is the ordinance to clarify the definition of structure for compliance with setbacks?
The first would be 17250, relative to the new smart overlay.
The overlay.
Another one would be the removal of the residential incentive overlay. That's 17.251. And the third one would be, as you say, the the other setbacks.
So item 17.250, 17, and you want to refer them as a group to both?
Sure. Yes.
Both committees.
Chairs, well,
so that's a motion to refer all three of these items to both legislative matters and community resources.
That motion.
Okay, is there a second?
Or maybe I'm amending an existing motion. That's easier for the minutes.
Motion, yeah.
Whatever works. Okay.
And there was a second?
Second.
We got a second. Okay. We're still talking, we're discussing referral at this point. Is everyone okay with that? Okay. All right. This is a voice vote. All those in favor of the referral, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Look at that. They just abbreviated the meeting by about 7.5 minutes. Thank you, Councilor O'Donnell. I have no updates for you. There are no information requests, and there's no new business pending, so there's one item left.
Move to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor of adjourning, please say aye.
Aye.
Thank you all very much. We are adjourned.
All right.